Mr. Chairman, I would be delighted to commit to making sure that the type, when someone comes forward, that witnesses violations of the law, and at great personal risk to themselves, sees abuses of power, and brings that forward at their risk to us, that we get to the bottom of those. We would not tolerate that type of behavior, and make sure that we do everything in our can, particularly in this case, as we saw today, the need to make sure that we properly enforce the Humane Standards Act is just paramount. And when people come forward to help us do that, they should be embraced, and that's what I commit to do in this administration.
Was he smeared? Dr. White smeared? Or is that okay? I want to know. I want to know how you view this as someone who manages a program, because you're setting a tone for other inspectors. Come on now, be direct. Was he smeared?
You know, Mr. Chairman, I met Mr. Wyatt first before this hearing for the first time.
Are you familiar with the record of what was said about him by FSIS high official?
Mr. Wyatt, Dr. Wyatt came in and met with some other high-level people in the agency and brought these things to our attention in terms of what he presented in his testimony, some of the actions that he had witnessed and how he had done that. And because of that, because of his status as a whistleblower and those things, we have begun an investigation. We're going to look into his charges and make sure that if there's information that we can use to improve how we do humane slaughter, we're going to do that.
Why won't you address how he was disparaged? Why won't you do that?
Again, I don't know. I met him today.
No, this is professional. This isn't whether he's a nice guy or what. This is about his professional work. But now, I'm not going to let you off here. Why won't you address that? That concerns me. You're sending mixed signals here, Mr. Mann.
In this administration, under this secretary, under this role that I have the opportunity to play here, we would not tolerate inspectors who bring forward humane handling complaints being in any way discouraged from that, or mistreated for that, or retaliated against that because of bringing those charges. I find that unacceptable, and we would not allow that.
Mr. Cummings, you can proceed. I'll come back to you.
How long have you been in the job, Mr. Mann?
Since July.
Since July. And were you familiar with Dr. Wyatt's case at all before today? The chairman just asked you a series of questions, and I was just wondering, were you familiar with the subject matter that he just talked about before today?
Yes.
And how did you come to learn about that?
After I saw the Humane Society videotape, I first became aware of it. And I also became more aware of it when Dr. White came and met with some other officials at the department and brought some of his concerns to us, and became aware that of his concerns and made sure that they're going to be looked into thoroughly and that we get to the bottom of it and take the correct steps.
And so what did you, and when did he came to you all?
It was last fall. I wasn't in that meeting, so I don't know the exact date, but I would guess, I don't know if you
last
know.
Fall? And tell me what you have done so far in response to what you learned.
Mr. Cummings, there are two events that need to move forward together here.
Sure.
The first thing we learned was that Bushway was behaving in a way that we just found completely unacceptable. And Secretary Vilsack asked our Inspector General to begin a criminal investigation of that. And that criminal investigation is ongoing. And Dr. Wyatt is part of that. And so initially there was a period of time.
That was referred to the Justice Department?
It's through our Inspector General.
The Inspector General, all right.
Okay.
All right.
At the same time, then, of course, Dr. Wyatt came to us with charges about how he had been treated that we also felt needed to be investigated right away. But as part of a the criminal investigation. We weren't able to begin our separate investigation until we reached a point in the criminal investigation where the IG's office enabled us to begin work on the charges that he raised. So that only happened in the last month. And so we've begun that investigation as well, and we want to complete it as soon as possible. And as I was talking to Dr. Wyatt before that, I think his experience, the examples he has brought forward, are extremely important to us in trying to design the humane handling program that we need.
Yeah. I take it that this administration, I hope, you just said a few minutes ago, has a policy of dealing with things a little different than before?
Yes, sir.
And can you tell us what the difference is? I mean, generally, I know it's...
Well, I you know, not in the last administration, but I'm seeing the types of things that we wouldn't stand for. Mm-hmm. And first of all, in humane handling, we need to do a better job. Mm-hmm. And I think the reports that GAO has provided us will help us do that.
Speaking of that, you know, in the GAO report, it finds that the inspectors in charge want more training on whether incidents require enforcement action. And it says, and I'm just wondering, is the department responsible for training of individuals in the various districts?
Yes, we train everyone who comes in and train.
You gave some testimony that you felt rather proud of the training. Are you? That's taking place now?
You know, I went through it myself, and I found it enormously helpful, and I found that it enabled me to understand exactly the types of things that we should be making sure don't happen. And I was talking to Dr. Wyatt before. I would enormously appreciate his experience in terms of being in the field and having witnessed the training and how it ends up in terms of the individual inspectors and the work they do. And if there are ways we can improve that training, I'm open to that as well.
Dr. White, did you have a comment? You look like you want to say something.
No, I just prefer to wait until I have a specific. I'm fine now.
What training does FSIS inspectors receive to ensure that they are prepared to enforce the Humane Methods of Slaughter Act? What is the training?
Every inspector comes in and gets, as part of their initial training, classroom training in the Humane Methods of Slaughter Act. Which goes over, for example, there are categories from unloading an animal off the truck as they're being moved towards slaughter, the stunning that must take place to make them insensible before slaughter. So it falls into sort of three broad areas in terms of the environment that the animal is in, how the animal is treated in that environment, and the stunning procedure, which is so critical because to carry out the law, the animal must be insensible, not able to feel pain at the time of slaughter. So they receive a classroom training in all three of those areas. They receive classroom training on the enforcement actions they're to take, that whenever they witness a violation of the act, they need to write a noncompliance record. And whenever they see an egregious violation, that cruel treatment of animals, for example, dragging an animal, what we witnessed in that videotape, that they must, in that situation, suspend. They receive that. Then they go, after they finish their classroom training, they have a week to 2 week in-field training as well, to take those lessons learned in the classroom and learn how to apply them in the field. And then we do refresher and updating training, as I described we did last year, and we'll do again this year.
One last question. You know, one of the things that is sort of shocking to the conscience, Mr. Mann, is what I said in my opening statement. When you've got an inspector standing there observing certain things that he's supposed to be stopping, and he's almost a cheering squad for wrongdoing. I mean, that... To me, then that makes me wonder, how deep does this go? Is there money being paid? In other words, to allow those kinds of things to happen? And I don't know, I know you've got an investigation going on with a lot of things probably, but we want inspectors to be inspectors. We want people to do their jobs. And if they don't want to do their jobs, then they shouldn't be there. Because the problem is when they fail to do their jobs, they fail the American people. And I refuse to pay people to kill me. That makes no sense. Or not to do their job. I mean, is that getting through to Secretary Vilsack and all the others?
Well, I share your outrage myself. And as I said in my testimony, I think Secretary Vilsack said it for all of us at USDA and FSIS when he said that the deplorable scenes recorded in the video are unequivocally unacceptable. And as I mentioned in my testimony as well, that as part of not only the criminal investigation we've done, that we have terminated one employee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Welch.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Wyatt, thanks for your good work on this. I'm sorry that I got here late, but what are the specific steps going forward you think should be taken in order to try to avert this happening again?
Well, there are several things. I mentioned several of them, I think, in my written testimony. I think it's extremely critical that we get an ombudsman's office in place, not only for humane handling, but food safety. Some place where the inspectors can go, if they have a weak supervisor that always grants appeals, you can't go above your supervisor, you're stuck. So we need that office where they have the freedom to go and somebody will listen to them, care about what they're telling them, and actually go to somebody in authority that will also take care of that problem. That's critical. We need whistleblower law enforcement and enhancement. I think it's important, the inspectors, it depends. A lot of small, medium, and large plants have a staffing shortage in the fact that the inspectors have a lot of work to do. They have a lot of work to do, and most of their time is spent on carcass inspection duties. And so they don't have time to do the humane slaughter enforcement. And when they do have the time, as I explained in my testimony, they shut off the line, they go do their humane slaughter. Well, the plant managers know where they're at. You're not going to do anything. So that's a problem. I think we need... for these chronic plants that rather than keep them in suspension and abeyance time after time after time, take the courage to spend. Take away their grant of inspection. They shouldn't be operating. It takes courage to do that, and we need that. We need fines in place. I think I mentioned that suspension actions sometimes can cause more inhumane handling of animals than...
No, I noted your concern about suspension sometimes resulting in more... harm to the animals than if you allowed it to continue under close supervision. Mr. Mann, do you agree with that? Well, the point that sometimes in order to be humane to the animals, it may make sense to allow a plant to continue in operation, of course under close supervision, rather than impose a suspension where the animals are then put in further jeopardy in very inhumane conditions.
Well, I do think that when it reaches the point where there's an egregious action and there's a suspension, that suspension is necessary till we can get the commitment from the company to correct that. But I also agree with you, sir, that there are situations the animals are there, and the length of that suspension could be result in further harm to the animals while that suspension is ongoing.
Okay. Now, Dr. Wyatt, I understand the Vermont Department of Agriculture was vigilant on this and cooperative.
Yes, they were involved in the whole closure of the plant, suspension of the plant.
Yeah, Mr. Albee, he was good to work with on this.
Yeah, well, I didn't have any personal contact with him, so, yeah, as far as I know from what I've been told, yes.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back. Thank you.
Ms. Shames, the Inspectors Union and consumer groups have criticized FSIS for not filling vacancies in plants and moving offline inspectors to fill gaps on the slaughter processing lines. That shift has come at the expense of humane slaughter and handling inspections. Are those criticisms substantiated? Could you pull that mic close so we can hear
yes.
you?
We found that FSIS is working without a current workforce plan to...
What does that mean?
It means that it really, at this point, has not identified the workforce level and skills that it needs to ensure that it is performing the humane handling activities
okay.
that it should.
Explain the implications of that for the consuming public.
What this means and what we found in an earlier report is that there are districts that are short-staffed. And to FSI...
What does that mean? What happens, though?
It means that that food safety activities, humane handling activities may not be getting the due attention that they ought to. And in fact, in our survey, when we asked what the challenges were for following humane handling, an overwhelming majority of the inspectors at the large plants said that they are hard-pressed to backfill. When there are vacancies, when people are taking their leave, it means that humane handling oversight is shortchanged.
Okay, so you found inconsistent enforcement across the districts. You found that five districts overseeing 56% of all livestock slaughtered nationwide did not suspend any plants during the study period. What does that suggest about the adequacy of enforcement?
Well, it shows that there are inconsistencies. For example, those five that did not conduct any suspensions were in Des Moines and Chicago, and those happen to be the first and second highest volume slaughter districts that FSIS has.
So you saw the tape, you saw the violations at Bushway. Was that just an isolated incident and there could never happen anywhere else?
What we know from our survey is that there are inconsistencies across the board. We see it within plants in terms of the various responses that we got, in terms of the enforcement actions that would be taken. We saw that across districts. We saw that over time.
When there's inconsistencies, what happens?
Well, the inconsistency is deciding what action ought to be taken when an inspector witnesses a humane violation.
Does that put, but at some point, isn't this a health issue?
Yes, the downer animals roll around in feces, and that can encourage or bring about E. coli. We know from the Westland Hallmark incident that there was a recall of the beef. Over time, while there have been fewer recalls of beef, the quantities of the meat that's been recalled has actually grown. So there is a connection there.
Okay, now, Mr. Mann, what does USDA inspected mean then? What, you know, should the public have confidence in that if you have so many deficiencies that that's being pointed out by GAO? You know, there's a stamp. USDA inspected. What does that mean?
It means something quite important for the public and something they can have confidence in. And something we're enormously grateful for the Congress in providing it to us. I had the privilege before I came to FSIS to do food safety at Food and Drug Administration. What that mark of inspection provides is it does not go on the food until our inspector can assure the food is safe. You don't have that. Another food. Now, we did do a great job.
What if you don't have
FDA
enough inspectors?
Food.
What happens? What if you have deficiencies, as GAO is pointing out? What does
again,
the USDA
I'm listening and very interested in.
Mean?
Sorry.
What does it mean?
I'm very interested in their findings and looking into that. But again, you know, Congress has provided us extraordinary opportunity and tools at FSIS and how we do food safety. We were required to do inspection of every animal, livestock, before it's slaughtered. We're required to do carcass-by-carcass inspection, every animal. We're required to be in every slaughter plant every day. Those are great tools that Congress has provided us to do that. If we don't have enough inspectors to do it, then the plant shuts down.
Does that mean there's a public health issue?
No, the plant shuts down. So I hear what she's saying.
How many plants have you shut down?
If we don't have someone who can put that...
No, name the plants that you've shut down. Just name a number of plants that you've shut down. Give
me the list. Well, we don't. And it's because we do have enough inspectors.
Pardon?
If we don't have adequate inspectors, mm-hmm. if they're not there to be able to examine every animal antemortem, if they're not there to be able to do carcass-by-carcass inspection, that plant can't run. And we're very thankful to the Congress that it's provided us both that law and the resources each year to make sure that we can do that.
So you're saying you don't have inspectors and the plant runs, but you do have inspectors and they do run?
Say that again, sir, sorry.
If you don't have inspectors, the plants can't run.
That's right.
And so how many plants have been shut down?
For that reason, none that I'm aware of.
Okay. You're short of inspectors.
I didn't say that, sir.
You have enough inspectors. Then why do you have deficiencies?
Well, you know, I want to read the report carefully. And because from the draft, well, we didn't see the final, but in the draft, I thought there was a lot of good information there that will help us do a better job. And the president with the Food Safety Working Group, the Secretary Vilsack, and the instruction he gave me when I came to the department, the reason I came and to government back again to do this work is because of their commitment to make sure that we provide safe food and humane handled animals. And so if there's lessons to be learned, but I do know, sir, that one thing that we have is having worked at FDA and others where they have to go about food safety in a very different way, but the way we're able to do it, where Congress has in the law required that we have inspectors in those plants continuously each day and has provided us the resources to provide the inspectors, is an enormously powerful tool, and we have a commitment to the public then to make sure that we're doing an outstanding job.
You've reviewed numerous noncompliance reports, other FSIS data. You've interviewed hundreds of inspectors. Based on your findings, do you think a slaughter plant owner faces a reasonable chance of suffering severe consequences for repeated abuses of animals and violations of the Humane Slaughter Act?
Well, that is actually a recommendation that we made in 2004, that FSIS's guidance need to be clear in terms of when an enforcement action should be taken. I think the Bushway example illustrates what we mean by this. There were three successive suspensions at Bushway before more drastic action was taken. And this is what we're getting at when we're saying that the guidance needs to be clear in terms of when an action should be taken.
Well, let me follow up with that. Do you think FSIS has in place the oversight and tracking capabilities necessary to know whether or not the kind of violations we've seen at Hallmark Westland or at Bushway are isolated incidents?
Inspectors do keep track of the time that they spend on humane handling activities. They do that in 15-minute increments, and FSIS can report that. But what we're finding is, and I think this is a rich source of information that FSIS has not taken advantage of, is reading through the noncompliance reports themselves. This is a responsibility that has been delegated down to the district level. We feel that if it were looked at from a departmental level, that the anomalies, the inconsistencies that we just described could help FSIS target the resources, target the training, take those actions that would help better its performance in terms of humane handling.
Thank you, Mr. Welch. Thank you. I just have a few more questions here. Dr. Wyatt, in your experience, what actions taken by your supervisors and management at FSIS have been the most counterproductive to the mission of enforcing the Humane Slaughter Act?
The most counterproductive is they actually encourage the plant to obstruct the inspector's work.
They encourage the plant to do what?
They actually encourage, by not supporting the inspector when he takes an enforcement action, they're encouraging the establishment for that action and further actions just to push the line in terms of egregious humane handling or any humane handling event or food safety. If you get, in my case, I was always shot down, so to speak, by my supervisors. I'd walk by a plant foreman, they'd laugh at me. I'd go up to trim, I'd give a rail inspector his break. Plant foreman would come up and tell my trimmer, "This guy doesn't know anything. Don't trim what he tells you, just trim what you see." I mean, that's an example of the most egregious action a supervisor can take, because when you don't support your inspectors, you're just as guilty as breaking the law as the establishment, in my view.
With what you have gone through as a whistleblower.
Yes, sir.
What did that USDA inspected label come to mean to you when you look at it after your experience? Tell us about that.
It's a very good question. We have the vast majority of our inspectors are terrific. I mean, the inspector at Bushway.
They want to enforce the law.
They do, and they work very hard. They work very hard under extreme difficult situations, circumstances, angry plant managers, the gambit. So they work very hard. So I'm very confident in that stamp of inspection. I disagree in the comment about the staffing. When I was at Seaboard, we had to pull our offline inspection people online all the time. We were short-staffed all the time at Seaboard. So there is a staffing problem.
Okay, so what are the implications of short-staffing? Why should the public be concerned about this?
Because when you pull an inspector, an offline inspector, online to fill an online vacancy, that offline task is not being done. Those tasks are being put into the computer, not performed.
What are those tasks?
Humane handling, sanitation, operational sanitation, check labeling, all kinds of things, HACCP, fecal contamination checks, all kinds of tasks are not being done because that inspector is filling another spot. The plant is operating, as he said. Sure, they're operating, but they're short-staffed. They don't have the staff to perform all the tasks that they're supposed to be doing.
So what does FSIS need to do at the upper management level to do a better job? What do they need?
In all of my 18 years of experience, I've never seen a district manager, deputy district manager, ever visit a plant in the field. We need to have those district managers, deputy district managers, out of the office visiting the plant, talking to the inspectors. They don't even know the names of most of their inspectors. They need to be out in the field talking to people rather than sitting in the office. That's what they need to do, in my view.
I want to thank the witnesses for being here. Now, a number of things have been said. I've been watching Mr. Mann try to get into the response here. Is there anything you want to say to respond to anything that's been said?
No, thank you.
Given the seriousness of the FSIS's role in assuring the safety of the food consumed by the American people, this subcommittee will maintain an active role of oversight of your division. I want to thank Ms. Shames for the report, which I think will provide some guidance, and I know you'll get a chance to go into it in depth, Mr. Mann. I hope you look at it carefully. And Dr. Wyatt, the country really owes you a debt of gratitude. You put your career on the line just to do the right thing. It's not easy for whistleblowers to take on a bureaucracy, a federal establishment. And you knew the risks, and you took the risks. And because of you, there are going to be established metrics to assure the public's consumption of certain types of food is going to be more rigorously inspected, and that there'll be a little bit better assurance, a little more public confidence in the process. So it's people like you are in a very proud tradition of individuals, good Americans who came forward and did the right thing, even when it was against their own personal interests. So this committee is quite appreciative of your actions, and I think that the Department of Agriculture owes you a public apology, and I want to thank you for being here. I want to thank the witnesses. This first panel is dismissed, and we're now going to go immediately to the second panel.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, while the witnesses are moving towards the table, I'm going to make some introductions so we can get right into this. Mr. Stanley Painter is the chairman of the National Joint Council of Food Inspection Local Unions of the American Federation of Government Employees, AFL-CIO. Prior to this, he served for 24 years as a USDA inspector, working in both poultry and red meat. He's held other positions in the Joint Council of Food Inspection Local Unions, including serving as the local president and vice president for Alabama and the Southern Council president. Mr. Bev Eagleston is the owner and founder of Eco-Friendly Foods, LLC in Mineta, Virginia, a small slaughter operation serving family farms in Virginia and the Mid-Atlantic region. Mr. Eagleston is an advocate for and a practitioner of small ethical family farming and raising pasture-fed animals. He raises, processes, markets, and distributes grass-fed beef, pork, lamb, poultry, and eggs at farmers' markets, home buying clubs, and many restaurants in New York City, Washington, D.C., and elsewhere. Mr. Wayne Pacelli, President and Chief Executive Officer of the Humane Society of the United States, which is the nation's largest animal protection organization with 11 million members and constituents, is our final witness. He served the organization in a variety of positions since 1994, and in his time as president and CEO, he has overseen several successful mergers of the Humane Society with other animal protection organizations. In the last decade, Mr. Pacelli and the Humane Society have worked for the passage of more than 500 new state laws and 25 federal statutes to protect animals. To the witnesses, it is the policy of our subcommittee and the Committee on Oversight and Government Reform to swear in all witnesses before they testify. I ask that you stand, raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you very much. Let the record reflect that each of the witnesses answered in the affirmative. Mr. Painter, you're our first witness on the panel. As I indicated in the other panel, keep your testimony under 5 minutes in length. Your entire written statement will be included in the record of this hearing. I ask that you proceed right now. Thank you.
Yes, sir. I'd like to start by saying that I'm here, although as an FSIS employee, I'm here representing my union and the food inspectors. Chairman Kucinich, Ranking Member Jordan, and members of the subcommittee. My name is Stan Painter, and I am the chairman of the National Joint Council of Food Inspection Locals, which is affiliated with the American Federation of Government Employees. I would like to thank you for inviting us to participate in today's important hearing on Humane Methods of Slaughter Act. The National Joint Council represents some 6,500 non-supervisory meat, poultry, and egg products inspectors who work for FSIS. We provide continuous inspection to some 6,300 domestic food establishments and 130 import establishments to ensure the safety and wholesomeness of product covered by the Federal Meat Inspection Act, the Poultry Products Inspection Act, and the Egg Products Inspection Act. Humane Method of Slaughter Act. Our responsibilities also include enforcement of the Humane Methods of Slaughter Act. As you know, the HMSA requires that livestock, before being slaughtered, are rendered insensible to pain by a single blow or gunshot or electrical, chemical, or other means that is rapid and effective. My union strongly supports enforcement of this act, and we take our responsibilities under this act very seriously. There's problems enforcing the act. Unfortunately, these problems with enforcing the act lie in what I've determined to be three categories. FSIS does not make enforcement of the act a priority. There are just not enough FSIS inspectors to keep up with the volume of livestock going to slaughter in the enforcement of the act and all of the other food safety laws and regulations. There is confusion as to what latitude FSIS inspectors have to enforce the act. Now, with regard to the first area, that is, number one, FSIS does not make enforcement of the act a priority. A good example of this is the basic training of inspectors to receive and carry out their responsibilities. This basic training just does not make the enforcement of the act a priority. I can speak from direct experience. Since this past July, I took a basic food safety regulatory essentials, FSRE, training that the agency offers to the inspectors. The instructor at the training spent only a few minutes out of the 13 days explaining the Humane Method Slaughter Act. Another example, when the Westland Hallmark scandal broke in 2008, the agency promised Congress that FSIS inspectors would receive additional training to enforce the provisions of the act. However, all we've received is a little online training module that we could access through the internet to refresh our knowledge about the responsibilities of the act, and there was no follow-up by the agency management to emphasize the importance in the enforcement of the act. Second, there's just not enough inspectors to keep up with the large volume of livestock going through slaughter to enforce the act and all food safety laws and regulations. We're still experiencing serious staffing shortages in various parts of the country. I do not have access to the staffing numbers for 2009, but through a Freedom of Information Act request, I have obtained the 2008 staffing numbers and have attached them with my written testimony. You will note that some FSIS regions are experiencing double-digit vacancy rates, especially the Albany district. The agency has worked in recent years to close the vacancy gap, but they are experiencing problems with, one, replacing the large number of retiring FSI inspectors, and two, closing the chronic staffing shortages which that region has suffered for years. Number three, third and finally, there is confusion as to what latitude FSI inspectors have to enforce the act. As a result of congressional concerns about the act enforcement, the agency a few years ago began hiring district veterinary medical specialists. They are responsible for acting as a resource to inspectors on the act in each of the 15 districts. Unfortunately, we rarely see the veterinary specialists visiting the plant. They are rarely in the field. We are hamstrung by our supervisors, who are either not qualified to do their jobs, unwilling to let us do our jobs, or are not committing to making animal welfare a priority, either in FSIS regulated facilities or in the private lives. In closing, I want to thank you again for inviting us to participate in this important hearing. I'll be happy to answer any of your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Eggleston. You may proceed.
Good afternoon, Chairman Kucinich, Ranking Member Jordan, the members of the Domestic Policy Subcommittee. I appreciate the opportunity to share with you my testimony in this hearing regarding the enforcement of the Humane Slaughter Act. I'm Bev Eggleston, founder and president of Eco-Friendly Foods. Located in Moneta, Virginia, for 7 years, our company has operated a USDA-inspected, small-scale, multi-species, certified humane slaughter plant, serving dozens of livestock producers, and it is this capacity that appear before you in the committee today. In April 2008, I appeared before this subcommittee as the only person doing what I do. The ability for my business to survive was in question, but today I'm here to tell you that the business has not only survived, but it has thrived despite many economic challenges. With the support of this subcommittee and the agriculture economies of many communities throughout the United States, we could benefit from the expansion of a safe, humane, and transparent model. The trend in the meat packing industry is that big guys are getting bigger and the small guys are disappearing. This trend towards consolidation raises several important issues for this oversight committee and should serve as a basis for congressional action going forward. First, there are significant concerns in the safety of our meat supply. The largest beef, pork, and poultry processors operate at high volume and high speeds that present many concerns. When hundreds of animals per hour are being processed, it is extremely challenging for inspectors to do their job and ensure the safety of our nation's food. Furthermore, when the meat of thousands of cows are mixed into single batches of ground beef, consumers are put at risk. The industry's only answer is to cook everything until it is well done, and not everybody will. And this only puts a Band-Aid over the real problem. At Eco-Friendly Foods processing facility, we only use one cow to make a single batch of ground beef. By not mixing our animal, we inherently minimize the potential for spreading any bacteria and contamination. Plus, because of our ground beef comes from just one cow, and if there was a batch of contaminated meat, which there never has been, it would be a small quantity and thus small exposure to consumers, and it would be also easily traceable. The size and frequency and the public health impact of numerous product recalls and foodborne illness outbreaks trace the products from the nation's largest packing operations are testimonial to these problems. Second, animal welfare. Not only does the high volume of and speed of large processing plants affect federal inspectors' ability to ensure the safety of our nation's food, but also inhibits their ability to comply with the Humane Slaughter Act. Furthermore, we believe that there are serious animal welfare issues not being addressed in the Humane Slaughter Act. American consumers are increasingly sensitive and insistent upon higher standards of welfare for the nation's food animals. At Eco-Friendly Foods, we respect the animals at all stages of its life, not just the antemortem stage addressed in the Humane Slaughter Act. Our animals are always treated humanely and are never subjected to any painful or stressful treatment. This attention to the welfare of our animals is reflected not just on our farms, but also on our loading, hauling, and offloading techniques, all the way through our very thoughtful method of harvesting and slaughtering. Without the availability of regional and local packing plants, too many animals must travel thousands of miles to be processed, and the problem endemic to the large plants are thus exacerbated. At Eco-Friendly Foods, we purchase livestock from over 40 small family diversified farms. Few, if any, of them would be able to continue in their livestock business if they did not have access to our plant and the premium prices we offer. There is a solution that not only mitigates food safety problems inherent in our high-volume industrial meatpacking system, but that also addresses the humane handling challenges mentioned. This solution is to widely replicate a model of small, regional, USDA-inspected multi-species slaughter plants. What Eco-Friendly has accomplished in the southwestern part of Virginia has brought many benefits to our family farms and the communities in which they live. Here's what I believe Congress can do to address the concerns related to the consolidation of meatpacking systems. First, there should be financial assistance in form of low-cost loans and grants for small-scale processing facilities that serve local communities. Second, in the interest of this wise allocation of the potential funding, we believe Congress should immediately authorize a rural economic impact study. Third, we need Congress to direct USDA to provide technical assistance to small-scale producers and processing facilities, and to educate the inspectors on the unique aspects to these small-scale processing plants' needs. Finally, the USDA has a one-size-fits-all to meet processing regulations that does not make sense. We need Congress to authorize an examination of current USDA regulations as they apply to small-scale processing facilities and to implement a new and distinct set of standards where appropriate. Ideally, there should be several, if not dozens, of these small local operating slaughter facilities available to farmers in every state and region. This would sustain the current growth in small-scale livestock raising and encourage a new generation of farmers to become producing members of our agricultural sector. The economic benefits to rural America in such investment would be substantial. Our total gross sales during the implementation of our model thus far is $3.1 million. $1.5 million has gone straight into the pockets of our producers. This directly stimulates their economies and jobs. In summary, Eco-Friendly Foods' growth is 326% since 2006. Strengthens my belief that the impacts and replication of such successful small-scale meat processing facilities across our country could be huge. Impacts could include the decrease of the cost of our nation's healthcare system and the carbon footprint, as well as increase our homeland security, our environmental protection, our rural economic stimulus, and humane treatment of animals. Growing American concerns of these issues are clear indicators that consumers desire to know what's on the end of their fork. I'm fully prepared to discuss further my experience in these topics, and I kindly thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, Mr. Eggleston. Mr. Pacelli, you may proceed with your testimony.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much for inviting me to testify, and I want to thank you for your commitment to animal welfare. I want to thank you also for continuing on with the examination of this important issue, this being the second hearing that you as chairman have instructed proceed. I will tell you that this is a very distressing issue for me personally. We have been really trying to work on this issue at the Humane Society of the United States from a variety of perspectives. We want to see USDA and FSIS succeed, And we have been working hard in Congress to see that the Agricultural Appropriations Committee and, of course, the entire Congress provide sufficient funding for enforcement. We've been distressed at the job that's been done through the years. And I do want to thank all of the witnesses here today for their testimony. I've learned a lot from it. And I do want to thank in particular Dr. Wyatt for stepping up. And I concur with your view that he acted courageously in stepping up and highlighting problems that unfortunately, from our vantage point, appear to be chronic. These are not just bad apples. There are systemic problems. And I will tell you, Mr. Chairman, that we are not a law enforcement agency. We're lucky to have so many millions of Americans support us, but we work on all animal issues. And we can't investigate every problem of animal cruelty and all of the harmful human-animal interactions in this country. But we have looked a few times at slaughter plants, and we've looked at intermediate transport points for animals like stockyards and auctions. And Mr. Chairman, every time we have looked, we have found problems. Not just the Hallmark Westland plant, where the abuses were egregious and where FSIS had a full complement of inspectors present, but also at Bushway. And in between, we looked at five auctions and stockyards in four different states. And at every turn, we found problems. We found mishandling of animals. We found downer animals being tormented. We found widespread use of electric shock, misuse of heavy machinery such as forklifts. So many different problems that we have come to see. And we desperately want to see progress in these areas. We worked with Senator Byrd and other members of Congress to push for the district veterinary medical specialists to be hired. And we saw that this was an opportunity to layer over the inspectors and to really put more attention on this problem. But we've seen in too many cases it's been more bureaucracy and that their attention has been diverted to other matters, not to humane handling issues, but to some of their other important responsibilities. But we believe that humane handling should be core to what the agency does. It shouldn't be an adjunct. It shouldn't be an occasional attention grabber. It should be part of the daily responsibility. And we're very distressed in the past about high-level officials suppressing proper enforcement, because that's essentially what Dr. Wyatt testified about today, is that his inspections, he's the thin blue line, if you will, at the plants, and when he tried to enforce the law, that information was suppressed and he was penalized. Now, I will tell you, Mr. Chairman, that I've had the pleasure of speaking with a number of senior USDA officials in this new administration. I'm encouraged by Secretary Vilsack's commitment to these issues. I was pleased to hear about Mr. Mann's comments, and we look forward to working with them. I want to thank them for immediately shutting down the plant once we provided the investigative footage. But now we have an opportunity for real reform. And just shutting down the plant is insufficient. We've got a moment now to really address these issues in a fundamental way. And I'm pleased to hear about the Humane Handling Enforcement Coordinator that Mr. Mann mentioned. That's important. I want to associate the Humane Society with Dr. Wyatt's comment about the importance of an ombudsman to provide inspectors with an avenue to take their concerns and grievances and to help ensure that they are able to carry out their responsibilities for both food safety and humane enforcement. Mr. Chairman, I really do believe that we need a mobile review team. Humane Society undercover investigators served that function by going undercover and getting behind the scenes and figuring out what's going on and documenting. USDA and FSIS should have its own mobile investigations unit. They should be transparent at times, but even undercover as necessary to sniff out problems that exist. And of course, inspectors who aren't doing their jobs should be fired. They should not be allowed to continue in this important role, because we're not just talking about billions of animals, we're talking about hundreds of millions of American consumers. What is greater in terms of the animal welfare suffering quotient and the human suffering quotient than our food supply? It is a staggering responsibility, and there should be a zero tolerance policy for failures in terms of the performance of the inspectors and the agency. Mr. Chairman, I'm going to wrap up, and I just want to mention a few things briefly in terms of other policy reforms, not just enforcement, but policy reforms. One is there's still a loophole in the federal downer law. These calves are legally held in some ways for these purposes. So there is a loophole that allows downer calves to be set aside and reevaluated for
policy. Explain what you mean by downer.
Yeah, downer animals are non-ambulatory livestock. They are animals who are unable to stand and to walk. And in March, the Obama administration closed a loophole on the downer issues. And some of that came to light through our Hallmark Westland investigation. But there's still a problem in enforcement because these young male calves, they're literally born just a few days before, are sent to these plants. And if they're under a certain size, they can be set aside and reevaluated for possible slaughter. And we think that is a problem. We've petitioned the USDA. We want the USDA to close that additional loophole. We also want to end the transport of baby calves to slaughter. As Dr. Wyatt said, these animals are just coming from the womb. They are not getting fed. They are babies. They are weak. And they're in long-distance transport. And then they're being occasionally, as we saw, mishandled at these facilities. And I think, Mr. Chairman, and finally, the biggest problem is that 95% of all animals slaughtered for food in the United States are not covered by the Humane Methods of Slaughter Act. All poultry are entirely excluded. 9 billion animals raised for food in the United States are not covered under the Humane Methods of Slaughter Act because they've been carved out. It's time for the Congress to close that loophole. We do believe that the Agriculture Secretary can designate poultry an amenable species and include them under the protections, but the Congress can act as well. Those are critical reforms, and we thank you for the opportunity to testify here today, and thank you for your commitment to this issue.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pacelli. Mr. Painter, in your testimony, you said that in 2009, you oversaw the slaughter, or we oversaw the slaughter and processing of 112 million domestic head of livestock and 6.7 billion domestic poultry animals. Are there enough inspectors to be able to assure that the food which the American people are consuming is adequately inspected and so fit for consumption so they can have confidence that what they eat they're going to be safe?
No, sir. Not only is there not enough inspectors, there's not the ability to do the job. We actually have a provision in our contract, our national contract, Article 5, Section 15, states that it's conflicting orders. And we actually had to put that provision in the contract because we were getting so many different orders in the field. You know, you're to follow the last instructions given. So, you know, it changes from day to day.
In your prepared testimony, you said the Enforcement of the Humane Slaughter Act is not a priority of the agency to enforce. What are the implications of that in your mind as someone who's worked as an inspector? What happens if the Humane Slaughter Act is not enforced?
You know, from what we're seeing in the field, it's just not a big issue. And it was said earlier.
It is not what?
It's not a big issue. I mean, it's something, it's a routine thing. Let's go out, let's do antemortem, and let's run back in the plant. That is.
You're saying that management hasn't made it a big deal.
Management has not made.
Do you think it's a serious thing?
I do.
Why?
And a number of things have brought out. Other than the cruelty to the animals, it certainly has a food safety aspect as well, which has been brought out before, you know, and our concerns are,
if you knew for sure that beef or poultry that was presented to you for consumption was not properly inspected and the Humane Slaughter Act was not enforced, would you have any misgivings about consuming such beef or poultry?
Certainly.
Why?
Well, number one, there's an ethical portion that I think that we're missing as agency employees. You know, we should have a high ethical standard. And I'm not saying that the inspectors don't have a high ethical standard. They do. But we get so much going on from our management. And let me give an example of what's going on.
What about the second thing? Tell me about the health issues.
Well, you know, as mentioned earlier, you have downer animals. They're laying in their own feces. And in the process, you can get E. coli contamination from animals that have been lying in their own feces, you know, and
Mr. Mand, who was up here earlier, is Mr. Mand still here? He seemed to imply that this is just an isolated case. Even the way the department handled it, they condemned it quickly, as they should. Is it an isolated case as far as you're concerned?
You know, I'll take a quote from a former governor of Alabama. It's not the first time it happened. It's just the first time they got caught. So, I have no reason to believe it's an isolated case because, as mentioned earlier, you know, part of the time is a staffing issue. And Mr. Mann mentioned that the slaughter lines, according to the Meat Inspection Act, they're supposed to be manned. You're supposed to have bird-by-bird and carcass-by-carcass inspection. But when you meet that, part of the time you don't meet the guidelines for other provisions.
I noted with interest the figures that you produced for this committee about the implant inspection vacancy rate. In other words, how many inspectors you're short, right?
Yes, sir.
Am I correct in saying that Des Moines and Chicago are two of the largest processing areas?
They are.
And what percentage of the livestock that's being processed goes through those areas?
I'm going to estimate probably about a half that go through the nation.
So if you have in Des Moines from February 8th, February of 08 to September of 08, if you have consistent double-digit deficiencies, what does that mean?
That means the slaughter line's going to be staffed and the offline duties are going to go by the wayside, such as the antemortem and humane slaughter.
And if you have in Chicago, which is the other major packing and slot, you know, slaughter and processing, double-digit implant inspection vacancy rates from April 08 through September 08, that means the same thing, I take it, right?
Yes,
and what
sir.
About in Albany? Albany, for some reason, is very high, 17.6%. It started in February 08 to 16.3% September 08. What do they process in Albany? Do you remember offhand?
Mainly Albany is processing areas. You have, the Albany district covers the plant in Vermont that's been a focus of this meeting. But
so would you say there could be a connection between then the adverse impact on the animals with respect to enforcement of the Humane Slaughter Act on one hand, questions of food safety on another, connected directly to not having enough inspectors?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, Mr. Pacelli, you testified that everywhere you've sent your investigators, they found animal abuses and legal violations. So you would dispute then the implication that when we saw quick action against, let's say, Bushway, that was just an isolated incident.
Well, I think, Mr. Chairman, not only, you know, if you're 7 for 7, if you have 7 investigations at facilities, stockyards or slaughter plants, and you find problems in every one, it doesn't really take a person with a lot of insight to come to the conclusion that there's probably a systemic problem. And I think compounding that, at Hallmark, going back to that investigation
right.
in 2008 in Chino, California, USDA had named Hallmark the supplier of the year as recently as 2005. And they had just touched, there were a couple of citations for...
Weren't they supplying beef for the school lunch program?
Yeah, they were the number two supplier to the National School Lunch Program.
And isn't that why a recall was established once it was revealed what, you know, the poor sanitation practices that existed?
Well, I think the concern was that these were downer cows. This was a cull cow slaughter plant. These were spent dairy cows, and many of them were incapable of walking. And the data from Europe, where people have died as a consequence of mad cow disease, showed that non-ambulatory cattle are 48 times more likely to have mad cow disease, or BSE, than ambulatory cattle. And then Mr. Painter mentioned the issue of fecal contamination. These animals are on the ground and they're wallowing in manure, and that can contaminate the machinery.
You sent all these inspectors out. I mean, were your inspectors, they were acting on tips, were they just lucky to find this? Or do you think that the size of the problem of poor enforcement of animal handling laws is a much bigger problem than we at this might really want to face?
Let me just say that at Hallmark Westland, there were five workers for FSIS, and that plant got consistently high ratings, and I believe there were 17 third-party audits that the company had paid for and always got the highest ratings. We had one guy who was an animal handler, so he was helping to offload the animals, and then he would move them toward the slaughter area. And he was there for 6 weeks and documented case after case of terrible abuses. I think, Mr. Chairman, that the issue is that, I mean, there are a couple of problems. Historically speaking, USDA has been too close to the meat industry. They've been a promoter of the industry. They haven't been a regulator. It's just become too incestuous. And this is what we're hoping that Secretary Vilsack continues in his efforts to really have a proper regulatory function. And I also want to mention that we've got problems with the law itself. The tool that the inspectors have is to shut down the plant. Under the federal law, there are no criminal penalties for serious abuses. That's why we had to go to the local authorities, to the district attorney. And then we also think there should be fines. I mean, these companies are treating these animals like meat machines.
Right. I would say that our subcommittee looks forward to working with you in drafting legislation that can make for more effective enforcement. I just want to ask the question that I keep hammering away at here. The connection between noncompliance of humane animal handling laws and food safety. What comment on that, please?
Well, I think the issue of downers, you know, it was debated for 20 years in this Congress, and the meat industry fought it every step of the way. We warned that a downer cow was going to be found with mad cow disease, and that's exactly what happened in 2003 at a slaughter plant in Washington State. What resulted was not only a food safety crisis, but more than 50 nations closed their markets to U.S.-produced beef, and that had a multi-billion-dollar impact. There was a study done that said it was a $12 billion impact. So the industry was penny-wise and pound-foolish. They're trying to extract every dime from the most hapless and suffering animals by pushing them ahead into the process to kill them. And they are potentially sacrificing, they're certainly sacrificing the well-being of those animals, but also the public. I mean, I quoted that information. But we know E. coli, mad cow disease, other problems are associated with the mistreatment and mishandling of animals.
I think it's really important that message gets out to the public, because if they think this is just a matter of people who have sympathy for animals that somebody's going to eat anyway, and so who cares? There is a direct connection between the enforcement of animal handling laws and food safety.
Well,
if people understand that, they should take an interest in how those animals are treated, right?
And it's more than just at the slaughter plants. You know, we're dosing animals on factory farms with antibiotics for non-therapeutic reasons. They're in overcrowded environments. And because the farms are so crowded, they know that the animals are going to get sick, so they try to dose them with antibiotics, which leads to antibiotic-resistant bacteria. These are the same classes of antibiotics that we use when children are sick or adults are sick.
I mean, I think you've made, in other appearances, the confined animal feeding operations a serious issue for public safety, as well as
the
humane
coming,
treatment of the animals.
And those are the animals coming to the slaughterhouses.
Well, let me do this. We're going to wrap this up in a minute, but I've got just a few questions of Mr. Eggleston. As you note in your testimony, the slaughterhouse industry is getting more and more concentrated into larger and larger companies. Is there a connection between the way we regulate the industry and increasing concentration of it and our bigger concerns, bigger companies, more adept in thriving under the specific regulations we have?
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I think that, in general, the scale in which the industry has built itself stands directly in the way, as my testimony stated, for inspectors to do their job. I just think there's too many animals, too high a pace for them to actually get their eyes wrapped around each animal to make sure that that animal is conducive for harvest or slaughter. The consolidation of the industry is why I felt like we had to do something different. I felt like if I felt like the industry was sound and appropriate in their oversight as well as their production, I wouldn't have had to go out and prove an almost unimaginable task of starting a small alternative parallel food system. So from farm to plate, we are in control of every single step. That's a model that I think brings an alternative to the huge consolidation. That consolidation is a threat to every American consumer because of the inability to make sure that every single animal is fit. Much like we've heard today in these testimonies, it's an incredibly uncomfortable environment to be put in a position as an inspector to have to oversee the wholesome and humane status that comes with that legend.
Well, you know, just finally, what do your consumers tell you about the pre-slaughter handling of the animals they're consuming?
Well,
and does it matter to them?
It definitely does matter. I know my customers on a individual basis. I speak to hundreds of them every week. We've been doing this for a decade. We also took some video clips of our customers to let them express to you. I'll make them available to your committee.
We would appreciate that. And I want to thank the witnesses and just make some closing remarks here. I want to go back to the previous panel and tell Dr. Wyatt how much we appreciate the fact that your courage resulted in us being able to bring this forward. I want to let Mr. Painter know that we know there are a lot of good people who are working for the USDA, and this subcommittee just wants to make sure that those people who really want to do their job can do it and aren't taking the wrong cues from top or upper line management. Just so you know, I mean, we appreciate the work that you're doing. And Mr. Eggleston, you are testimony that there are producers who are doing the right thing. And they want to do the right thing. They want to set high standards. And Mr. Pacelli, the public owes you and the Humane Society a debt of gratitude for taking the risks and sending investigators undercover to be able to show what's really happening. So we break this myth of everything's just fine and no one has to worry about the food they consume. It's okay because it has that stamp on there. You've really performed a public service. And as chairman of this subcommittee, I really appreciate it. We're going to maintain an ongoing interest in this issue. So as you get information, the Humane Society does any investigations, you can come forward and, you know, we'll look at it. And the same thing with Mr. Painter. If you get information, if there's whistleblowers, people trying to do the right thing, they're getting hammered, if that still happens, and it may not under the new administration, you can bring that forward to this subcommittee. I just want to make a final personal comment, and that is, as chairman of this subcommittee, you know, I've conducted this hearing in a way that has been impartial. But, you know, I don't eat meat. I don't eat chicken. I don't eat fish. Now, I don't feel that I have a right to tell people what to eat, but I don't do that. I don't eat the Humane Slaughter Act, Mr. Pacelli. I think it's an oxymoron, a contradiction in terms. However, one thing I will guarantee you, that for those Americans who do consume those food products and who rely on the government to make sure that those products are safe, this subcommittee will relentlessly pursue the food safety issues, and the industry can count on that. This is the Domestic Policy Subcommittee. I'm Congressman Dennis Kucinich, chairman of the subcommittee. Today's hearing has been continuing problems in USDA's enforcement of the Humane Methods of Slaughter Act. I want to thank all the witnesses in both panels. I want to thank those in attendance and those who are watching. This committee stands adjourned.
Just talk to him. We didn't know.
What am I going
to
do? Argue with the man?
Marriage ruined my life. Oh, no. Oh, no, if you will. Not now, Cliffy. Do me a favor. Take Uncle Roger out there. Find Frazier. Now, get him some therapy fast.
Sure thing. Okay, buddy boy, let's go.
Are you married?
No, sir, I'm not. Came close once, but no.
Well, she was a lucky girl.
Thank you, sir.
What's the holdup? Where's Dr. Chatfield?
Dr. Chatfield has challenged the chef and the waiters to a foot race in the park. And that's where they are now, foot racing.
Sir, the minutes will be ready in about 5 minutes.
Well, then I'll just use this opportunity to get the champagne out of the wine closet.
Good idea.
Everybody loves wine, Rebecca.
No.
Too dangerous. Let me go down there for you.
I'm just going to select a vintage.
Rebecca, can you sew a button on for me?
Kelly, what are you doing down here in the kitchen? But now that you're here, let me get a look at you.
Oh, yes, yes. Let's all look at her. Yeah, Kelly, you stand right over there by the path there. Oh, yeah. Oh.
Isn't she beautiful?
Yes, yes, yes. I'm just a bartender, but even a dumb waiter like me can see how beautiful she is.
Oh, look at her, Mr. Gay. Turn around, Kelly. Look at that dress. Look at that hair. Look at that train. Well, you're just a little store-bought princess, aren't you, Kelly?
Oh, Cliffy! You're just in time here. The bride and her father would like to have a shot of before the wedding.
Oh, yeah, sure thing there, Sammy. Okay, now just look at me.
Just look at Cliff.
Oh!
Coming through, sir, coming through. Oh. Okay, here we go. Let's get another one this way.
Yeah, good idea. We'll spin right around here.
Spin around.
I'll get a picture of your baby blues.
Oh, you blinded me with that damn flashlight.
Will you be reasonable?
I tell you, I won't perform another wedding. What the devil was that?
Maybe it was the radio.
Oh, yeah, turn off that damn radio.
I'm going to split in the headache. I'm going to go upstairs and lie down.
No, sir. Well, you got to pick a vintage here so we can drink champagne.
You eat a lot of sugar, son.
No, sir. I'm just a fool for weddings.
What are you doing dressed like that? Come on, Mr. Gaines, good to see you. Get out.
I still need to have my button sewed on. Woody was kidding around and he kind of bit it off.
Where is the button, Kelly?